Hi everyone. Today in this video, we are going to discuss about prednisolone. Prednisolone is one of the glucocorticoid which is useful as anti-inflammatory agent as well as immunosuppressant. This drug can be used in the various conditions which are associated with inflammatory response. It can be used in the inflammatory bowel disease as well as ocular inflammation. It can also be used in the allergic skin reactions, inflammatory musculoskeletal disorders, respiratory disorders, and neoplasia. In this way, this drug is having a wide variety of clinical indications. So today in this video, we are going to discuss how this prednisolone acts, what are the important precautions, side effects, and doses we will discuss in this video. So prednisolone is having a wide therapeutic activity. It can be used in the treatment of ulcerative colitis as well as Crohn's disease. Both are inflammatory bowel disorders. Similarly, it can also be used in the joint disorders such as rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis. So many of the arthritic conditions can be treated by this prednisolone. Similarly, it can also be used as anti-cancer agent, particularly in the treatment of acute leukemia as well as lymphomas, even neuronal disorders like multiple sclerosis, or any hypersensitive reactions like atopic dermatitis, respiratory disorders such as asthma and COPD. In all these conditions, prednisolone can be used as a glucocorticoid where it acts as anti-inflammatory agent as well as immunosuppressant. Now let us the chemical nature of this drug. So this is the structure of prednisolone. We can clearly observe the steroid structure. So let us give the numbering. So numbering will be like this. So it is having 21 carbon steroid nucleus, which is nothing but pregnane. So prednisolone is a pregnane derivative, and this pregnane nucleus is having the two double bonds. So it can be written as pregnane 1,4-diene, because double bonds are present at first and fourth position, and ketone groups are present at third and 20th position. So prednisolone is a pregnane 1,4-diene 320-dione derivative. Hydroxyl groups are present at 11th position, 17th and 21st position. So we can write this as 11-17-21 trihydroxy. That is a complete name of prednisolone. Now let us see how this drug acts. Prednisolone can show variety of actions. It can mainly affect the liver, where it is going to increase the hepatic gluconeogenesis, and it can also reduce the glucose uptake and utilization so that it can increase the glucose levels. And it can also increase the lipolysis, breakdown of the fat, and increase the catabolism of proteins. Similarly, it can affect the renal system, where it is going to increase the glomerular filtration rate. Thereby, it can increase the excretion of calcium, potassium. It can also increase the urate excretion. And it can also inhibit the eosinophils activity, as well as it can also inhibit lymphocytes, which are mainly responsible for anti-inflammatory as well as anti-allergic response. Inflammatory mediators like IL-1, interleukin-1, as well as TNF-alpha, they can act on their corresponding receptors. So when these receptors are activated by these mediators, they can stimulate one of the pathway, NFKB pathway, nuclear factor kappa B pathway, which is associated with IKB. Now they can interact with the DNA within the nucleus. Now this NFKB complex can interact with the DNA, where it is going to produce transcription of inflammatory mediators, and it can release various types of cytokines which produce the inflammatory response. Now prednisolone can reduce this inflammatory response. Being a steroid, now this drug can act on the glucocorticoid receptors which are present within the cytoplasm. But these glucocorticoid receptors are associated with one of the protein HSP90, heat shock protein 90. Now this prednisolone can enter into the cell and it can bind to the glucocorticoid receptors, where this HSP90 is going to be dissociated and glucocorticoid receptors are internalized. Now they can undergo dimerization and can interact with the DNA, such that they can undergo gene transcription so that they can prepare an mRNA. Now this mRNA can bring the protein synthesis so that they can prepare few of the proteins such as NXNA1. This NXNA1 can inhibit the synthesis of various prostaglandins and other inflammatory mediators which are derived from Cox pathway. In this way, inflammatory response can be controlled by prednisolone. Similarly, it can also reduce the gene transcription of IL-2, which is another cytokine responsible for proliferation of immune response. And the glucocorticoid receptors activated by prednisolone can also interact with this NFKB, where they can inhibit its activity, such that the gene transcription of inflammatory mediators can be inhibited. By all these actions, prednisolone can reduce the inflammatory response, as well as it can also reduce the immune response. What are the precautions? One of the important precautions of prednisolone is that this drug can reduce the immunity, so T cell activity is going to be reduced, which results in the immune suppression. So this drug can increase the risk of infections. So if a patient is already having any previous history of infections, they can be further increased. So prednisolone can increase the latent tuberculosis. It can also increase the varicella zoster infection, which produces the chickenpox. It can also increase the strongyloid infections and fungal infections. So bacterial, viral, fungal, amoebic, all types of infections may be increased by prednisolone. So care should be taken to check any symptoms of infections developed in the patients when this drug is used for long-term periods. Similarly, this drug can suppress the HPA axis, resulting in the increased glucose levels, hyperglycemia, and it can also produce some salt and water retention due to mineralocorticoid activity. Even it can precipitate Cushing syndrome, resulting in the facial edema and other symptoms related with excessive cortisol levels because of this prednisolone. That's why this drug should not be stopped suddenly. The drug should be slowly tapered in order to reduce any adrenal insufficiency or suppression of HPA axis. Similarly, prednisolone can affect the electrolyte levels. It can affect the potassium, calcium, sodium, and water levels. Particularly, the excretion of electrolytes through the kidneys is going to be affected. Few of the electrolytes, such as sodium, is going to be absorbed, and water is also going to be absorbed, such that they can increase the blood pressure, as well as they can increase the fluid retention. But few of the minerals, such as potassium and calcium, they are going to be excreted through the kidneys. So prednisolone can reduce the potassium as well as calcium levels, which may affect cardiovascular system, such that this hypokalemia and hypocalcemia may precipitate congestive heart failure as well as cardiac arrhythmias in the patients. So again, the electrolyte levels should be closely monitored when this drug is prescribed for chronic period. Similarly, prednisolone can reduce the calcium levels, so it can reduce the calcium absorption through the intestine, as well as it can also increase the calcium excretion. Because of these two actions, the serum calcium availability is going to be reduced, which results in the decreased bone mineral density. Similarly, it can also reduce the estrogen production, which further reduces the bone mineral density. So prednisolone can increase the risk of osteoporosis in the patients. Particularly in the postmenopausal women, this risk is more pronounced. So care should be taken when this drug is prescribed in the postmenopausal women. Similarly, prednisolone can also affect the eye, where it is going to increase the risk of cataracts as well as glaucoma in the patients. That's why when this drug is prescribed for 6 weeks, then intraocular pressure should be checked in order to assess any development of glaucoma within the patients. And this drug can also affect the optic nerve. Since this is an immunosuppressant, prednisolone can increase the development of herpes simplex infections, which damage the optic nerve, resulting in the further loss of vision. Similarly, prednisolone can also affect the gastrointestinal system, and it can increase the intestinal perforation. And it can also affect the central nervous system, where it can produce some mood changes within the patients, resulting in the development of euphoria as well as insomnia within the patients. What are the side effects? The important side effects of prednisolone are mainly related with salt and water retention. So it can produce some edema, hypertension, and it can also produce some hypokalemia, loss of potassium, hyperglycemia, increased glucose levels. Increased appetite can also be observed within the patients, which results in the increased weight gain and some acne, decreased bone mineral density, and risk of glaucoma can be observed within the patients. How it is given? This drug is available as tablet, as well as solution, syrup, and even IV injection, as well as topical cream. In all these dosage forms, this drug is available. The initial dose of the drug is variable from 10 mg to 60 mg. But for multiple sclerosis, it can be used up to 200 mg. But when this dose is going to be reduced, the dose should not be stopped suddenly. The dose of the drug should be slowly withdrawn in order to reduce any adrenal insufficiency and related symptoms. So that's about this drug, prednisolone. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.